I'd like to call this meeting to order. Would you please stand with me and recite the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. First item on our agenda is a proclamation, and I believe Commissioner Moore is going to read that. It's about our round graduation matters.
Okay, I was so excited to get here that I don't have my copy. May I read?
Well, here you go.
I set in my car. We have to take a short break.
There you go.
Okay, here we go. City of Shelton Proclamation. Whereas the mission of the Shelton School District is to assure that all the students achieve at high levels and possess the knowledge and skills to be responsible citizens and enjoy productive and satisfying lives. And whereas Shelton's locally elected school board is the core of the public education governance system in our city. And whereas the district serves more than 4,000 students and has an annual budget of nearly $51,169,000 and employs approximately 800 people. And whereas school directors play a crucial role in promoting student learning and achievement by creating a vision, establishing policies and budgets, and setting clear standards of accountability for all involved. And whereas school directors are directly accountable to the students, to the citizens in their districts and regions, serving as a vital link between members of the community and their schools. And whereas school directors provide a passionate voice of advocacy for public schools and the welfare of school children, now therefore, the Shelton City Commission does hereby proclaim May 1st, 2016 through June 15th, 2016, a celebration in support of Graduation Matters Shelton.
Thank you very much. What do we do at this point? Do we clap? Or? You want to make a motion? Okay. Could we have a motion here to proclaim this Graduation Matters? So
I will make a motion to proclaim May 1st. Is that the date? May 1st, 2016? Or May 2nd?
May 1st,
2016 through
June 15th, 2016
as
a celebration in support of graduation.
Celebration in support of graduation. Graduation matters.
I second that motion.
There's a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right. We proclaimed it. Very good. Now, in my little notes here, I don't have a spot for us to do our little commission reports, but I think we would do them at this time. So, okay. Commissioner Moore.
Okay.
Button.
Uh-huh. Okay. Thank you. So, first of all, I would like to report on our Arbor Day celebration that was last Friday. It was awesome. It was amazing. It was very well attended. I thank Commissioner McDowell for being there and being the cheer squad. It was amazing event, and I think it's going to get better each year, and it's fun to see the many schools getting involved, and it's fun to see the residents of Maple Glen really take heart and take this event on as being important to their lives. And so it was a really good occasion. I had a lunch meeting with a constituent today Tomorrow I'm going to be attending a Kiwanis meeting. I'm joining Kiwanis. And I also am still doing the United Way site visit, so I will be visiting Crossroads Housing tomorrow afternoon. Wednesday briefings, and then on Friday, the State of the Community sponsored by the Chamber at Mason County PUD. And that's it for this week.
Commissioner McDowell?
Tomorrow morning I have my left board. That's law enforcement officers and firefighters. So if anyone wants to know what that is, that's what that is. Wednesday, nothing. Thursday, I have my morning briefing. And then I am going to be at the ribbon cutting at High on the Hog at 4:30. And Friday, State of the Community at the PUD from 11:30 to 1. And I wanted to mention that Arbor Day that we celebrated at up there, it was really fun to see the baby pear tree grafted from one of Davis Shelton's that will be going up there, which would be exciting. So the life just keeps going on. Thank you. And that's it.
Thank you. Wednesday, I will be attending an Economic Development Council Regulation Subcommittee. On Thursday, I might be touching bases with CGI for a little advertising thing I've got in here. I will also be attending the grand opening for High on the Hog Barbecue, and I'll be playing guitar in the band. So just in case anybody wants to come and see me, that's where I'll be.
We're going there to eat, not watch you.
Well, some people... I mean, we all like barbecue, but some people may want to see me play guitar.
I'm sorry.
I mean, guitar players do this.
It is. Okay. It goes good.
All right. So that's Thursday. Friday, I will also be attending the State of the Community event there, sponsored by the Chamber at PUD 3, not PUD 1. And that completes our – I want to also mention that we do have a guest here from – and always we honor – other council people, that government employees from other areas. So we have a gentleman from the city of Chehalis. And are you a sitting council member now?
Yes, sir.
Could you please just tell us your name so we can thank you for coming to our meeting?
My name is Karen Lund. I've been a council member about 16 years. Oh.
Thank you for attending our meeting tonight, Daryl. We appreciate that.
Can I say something?
Absolutely.
Okay. I just want to give a little report. I went last Tuesday to the Association of Washington Cities, Small Cities down in Toledo. If you've ever been to Toledo, it's a charming little community. It's really cute. It was just kind of zeroing in on the small towns, and there was Vader was there, and Toledo, and Shelton, and then a couple other little towns that I've never even heard of before. But anyway, they're all in the same boat trying to swim up the sewer with issues. And so it was nice to be able to share what's going on in Shelton, some positive things. And it was just a great evening to be there. So I was glad I was able to go.
Very good. Can I say something?
You may.
Okay. I also, last Wednesday, attended a mayor's exchange in Eastern Washington. And when we go on these things, we have the opportunity to meet other local councils and mayors of other cities that are going through, have gone through, or are about to go through many of the things that Shelton experiences. And I have some very, very wonderful information that I'm coming back with, so you'll be hearing probably more about that information in the future. It's just we don't have the time quite to go into it, because we have a process here where we want to kind of vet stuff before we say it. And so, but anyway, these little events we go to really help us in governing the city of Shelton, because it gives us an outside look on what other cities have gone through. So anyway.
And Vader is a community of 600 people, and
wow,
they are having to do a new sewer plant, water plant. They have no idea how they're going to pay for it. And their water and sewer bills right now are just as high as what we pay here in Shelton, and they're going to go up, and they don't have any idea what they're going
to
do.
They would be good to think about joining that sewer funding coalition.
Yes, I talked to them.
Anyway. Okay. Enough of that. We're going to move on now to a very important subject. This is about the Simpson Roundhouse Feasibility Study. So I want to turn this meeting at this point over to Steve Goins, and then he can kind of run this next section for us.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. We have a presentation tonight. As you're aware, Simpson has sold the mill downtown, and there's sort of a response to that. There's been a lot of discussion about some of the history and legacy of Simpson. They operated a mill there. They were, I guess, a you could say, a founder of Shelton in many ways, taking advantage of the forest we have here in terms of logging, as well as the railroads that help access those forests. Marie Thompson from Artifacts Consulting is here. She prepared a report, which I provided you a copy of, the feasibility report on the options for the roundhouse. Simpson has discussed the options with the city, and in fact, they commissioned this report. One of the features she'll talk about is the turntable that's there. There's very few of these left in Washington, probably on the West Coast. It's certainly an asset that we have an opportunity to preserve, as well as figure out what our approach is for promoting that and the history of the facility. So, without further ado, here's Marie Thompson.
Thank you, Steve. And thank you for all your help in putting this report together. I understand you have the full report as well as kind of a synopsis for this this evening. And so I'm just going to take you through hopefully about the key points here and about the findings of our report. And I encourage you to ask questions as we go along. I've only got about four slides here, trying to be brief, but I'm certain that there will probably be questions. First of all, just a 2 minutes on who we are and what we do at Artifacts. We are a consulting firm specializing in historic preservation, cultural resource management. We're working primarily in Washington, but also in Oregon and California. We work on a variety of projects for local governments, for federal governments and state governments, as well as private developers and nonprofits. We specialize in preservation planning, historic tax credit work, National Register nominations, context statements, building analyses, grant writing, and feasibility studies. And just a couple of recent projects include preservation plans for the cities of Puyallup and Yakima, working with McMenamins on the Anderson School in Bothell, and the upcoming Elks Lodge in Tacoma, which will be wonderful. We were historic preservation consultants on Union Station rehabilitation in Seattle, and we have recently completed historic surveys for the Highline Community College and Evergreen State College campuses. So that is background to show you that we have a wide range of things that we work on, and so we see a lot of different kinds of historic preservation work. We were approached in late 2015 by Dave McEntee at Simpson, and we're asked to do sort of an initial evaluation of the roundhouse and turntable and to begin looking at scenarios that could be focused on the potential reuse of this as a museum property. Our approach in doing that, we're still on slide one, our approach in doing that is to acknowledge that we are not the railroad experts. And I say that in self-defense because I think there's a bunch of them over here. We are not the railroad experts, but we do have quite a bit of experience, and I think we're quite skilled in adaptive reuse, repurposing older buildings for more contemporary uses. But we did a great deal of research, existing reports and plans, and a good deal of internet research. Conducted interviews with 21 individuals in the Shelton area and even outside the area, either as individuals or as groups or through email or telephone. And thanks to all of those people for giving of their time. Some of them are here in this room. We looked at models of other railroad museums, principally the California State Railroad Museum in Sacramento and the Mount Rainier Scenic Railroad running from Albee to Mineral. And we did those two models deliberately because one is very large and publicly funded, and one is rather small and more privately funded. So it gave us a range of issues and approaches to those issues. Next slide, please. Let me take you through the site a little bit. You are probably far more familiar with it than we are, but clearly on the right-hand side, there is the roundhouse and the turntable in red. To the yellow is the maintenance shop to the north. There is the communications shed or the dispatch office, safety alley to the south, as well as the well house. The tracks that are running and Front Street there. Site conditions, all the pictures on the left show you the condition of the turntable at this point. There are some existing original windows in the roundhouse, and of course there's quite a bit of rolling stock in the roundhouse, as well as parts and supplies and just a hodgepodge of different things.
Yes. I'll start the question thing because you said we can kind of interrupt.
Please.
What is rolling stock?
Well, we go back to that slide. Each gentleman can tell you. When we go back to the slide, there is a picture of a locomotive. That is rolling. That's part of rolling stock.
A locomotive is rolling stock.
Indeed, or any of the cars, anything that is operational.
Okay. Well, thank you.
You may also hear me refer to static exhibits, and those are things that are not operational but are used for interpretation.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. With the site, there are a number of issues, and you are probably very familiar with them. I would say the number one issue is access. How to get people into an operating industrial site so that they might be able to visit or even work on rehabilitation or even volunteers being able to work on some of the rolling stock. Of course, the main entrance to the property. There is a grade level pedestrian crosswalk, for lack of a better term, near the roundhouse itself. There's another site to access the entire property to the south with access over the bridge across Goldsboro Creek. None of them are ideal for this situation. This is an active, ongoing industrial concern, and there are real issues around safety and around directing traffic. We did not come up with any great solutions there other than to indicate that there are these issues that will definitely have to be resolved before things can go further. There are rail lines, various rail lines coming in and out of the facility. Some are active, particularly the Burlington Northern / Navy rail that goes to Bangor. What the Navy may have to say about a proposed museum there. Or access across their tracks is unknown as well.
It's all right.
There's quite a bit of rolling stock, as I said, and there are environmental issues that we probably don't even know yet. I cannot detail them for you because we're not environmental engineers, but I am assuming that there will be some environmental remediation that will have to be conducted here. Traditionally, turntables were places where people dumped lots of chemicals and things like that, so it's very likely that there will be some issues there. Our conclusions after doing our interviews and our research, a few I want to just go through with you before we move on to the next slide. The number one conclusion is that this is an incredibly significant historic property. It is amazingly significant. There are only two roundhouses in the state of Washington, this being one. The other is up in Seattle in the Inner Bay area. For those who are involved with railroads, turntables and roundhouses are the gold standard. They are incredibly impressive. I'll point out that the California State Railroad Museum is a modern museum built to resemble a roundhouse with an existing turntable. They're that important to railroad history. Okay. So this is a property. The roundhouse and the turntable by themselves could be listed on the National Register of Historic Places by themselves, or they could be part of a larger district that would incorporate some of the rail lines and other pieces of property, other buildings on that site. The roundhouse and turntable are in relatively good shape, given their age and the effects of the weather and the elements. They've been taken well, good care of. The site, however, is inadequate. Just the roundhouse and turntable itself are inadequate for a museum complex. It's simply too small to incorporate all of the elements of a museum, including administrative offices, archival space, laboratories, places to do repairs. So we would have to look at additional space either on site with existing buildings or new construction, either on site or perhaps across the street or in other places. We feel very strongly that a museum in this structure could stimulate additional economic development and tourism in Shelton, and augmenting other tourism that is already happening in Mason County. And we were quite impressed with a number of tourism-related kinds of facilities and industries that are occurring here in Mason County. But this could be a game changer in terms of tourism. The goal for any tourism is to get people to stay overnight, and in order to do that, you need many attractions and opportunities for people to be able to shop, to eat, to do all of the things that they like to do. We also found that there is a large and active core of volunteers, not only in railroad volunteers, not only in Shelton, but throughout the region. And part of that is due to the fact that we do have other railroad museums at Elby, at Snoqualmie. And far from being in competition, I think what that does is creates a nexus of different kinds of railroad-related museums so that the whole is greater than the individual.
Not to break your continuity there, but theoretically, the one in Seattle is a replica. Is that correct?
No, the roundhouse in Seattle is original, and it's still working.
Okay. So we would.
It's original Great Northern Railroad Roundhouse.
Right. So we would. There's only two. This is the only other one that's been possibly saved.
Correct.
So only two in the state.
Correct.
Well, that's a great advertisement tool.
It is. And as I said, we think there's great opportunity to create some synergy with some of the other railroad museums to provide a very broad experience for people who are interested in railroads here. There could be an excursion train associated with this museum. Excursion trains are important pieces of the financing, frankly, of a lot of other railroad museums. They provide revenue streams. They're a great attraction, but there are a host of issues that have to be resolved before an excursion train could operate here. Many hurdles, not the least of which is what's the destination? Because every excursion train has got to have a destination that appeals to people, where something to do and something to see. A couple of ideas for destination include the Truman Glick Park in Matlock, but also Dayton, the sorting yard at Dayton. And it is thought that it might be possible to construct additional museum facilities at that location, as well as visitor facilities, restrooms, cafes, that kind of thing for visitors. And thinking big here, we'd even thought that it might be possible to use the Dayton Yard as a jump-off point for planned excursions, both biking, maybe horses, or hiking to the Vance Creek Bridge. Now, the Vance Creek Bridge is an amazing edifice in and of itself. And if you go on YouTube, you will see hundreds of people who have illegally made the trek to Vance Creek Bridge to have photographs and videos filmed of themselves there. But it is a well-known site by hikers and railroad buffs alike, and could offer some opportunities. And finally, our conclusion is that there is no one single entity in the Shelton area that is capable of sponsoring a museum. it must be a community collaboration. This is a big project, and it would require the cooperation of everybody, all of the major groups in the community in order to make it happen. Okay, next slide, please. So we developed, we developed three strategies for reuse. But first of all, we thought that there needs to be a period of feasibility testing here. And by that, we meant doing some due diligence around what are the environmental concerns, what are the utilities issues, what are the egress, the access and egress issues, and what would a market analysis say about putting a museum here and what it could support. So we felt that that was very important to do. And you'll see what we ended up thinking is that this period, initial period, would cost somewhere between $80,000 and $165,000 and probably could be wrapped up by the end of 2017. That would give you a much better and much clearer idea of the situation that you're dealing with. So that then moves us on to the three strategies that we are recommending for consideration.
Mary?
Yes.
I'm sorry, can I interrupt you? What was
please.
What was the dollar amount that you just mentioned?
Now, we have a wide range in the report because we were asked to, but it's $80,000 to $165,000 okay. for that phase. The first strategy that we wanted to present to you was simply mothball the roundhouse and museum for future development. And that is basically to simply take care of it, secure it, do some minor repairs and we're thinking about perhaps a five-year period here so that people can get a grip on sort of the financing and the details involved in a museum. And mothballing is actually a term of art in historic preservation. There are very clear standards for how you mothball a historic building. This building, as I said, is in pretty good shape, but there are some minor repairs that need to be made. We would advocate also removing the electrical substation adjacent. It's not being used at this point. Securing the building against both people and critters and any other kind of invasions, and monitoring. And we figured that this particular scenario would cost somewhere in the vicinity of $160,000 to $450,000. For about a five-year period. The second scenario that we're looking at is the full-blown, high-quality railroad museum here. And as I said, we also, as I said earlier, the site is simply too small to do a quality kind of museum with just the roundhouse and the turntable. Ideally, we would be looking at that maintenance building to the north. But there could be other new construction, as I mentioned, at Dayton or possibly elsewhere on Front Street. We anticipate that there would be some short-term mothballing that would be involved here, while all of the sort of pre-development things get going. And that pre-development phase could be a couple of years as agreements get negotiated and finalized, as environmental issues are addressed, as permits and approvals are gotten and a financing strategy is developed. But we figure somewhere between 2018 and 2024, a museum could open with a cost of somewhere between $7 million and $20 million, depending on how big and how extensive. And again, what I want to point out too is that this really relies on that core of volunteers being active. Every railroad museum that we studied relies definitely on volunteers to do the rehabilitation of the rolling stock, to man the trains as they're running, to work on the rails, all of that. So it's imperative that volunteer energy get harnessed to make this possible. And the third scenario is a sort of a hybrid. And this comes, frankly, from our experience working with McMenamins. And that is to couple a museum perhaps more a museum light with a private development, perhaps a small hotel or conference center. We're thinking in the vicinity of 40 to 60 rooms, more boutique than chain, where the roundhouse becomes space for meetings, events, and exhibitions. You could still have exhibitions within the roundhouse. You could still do exhibitions potentially on the grounds. You could still do your excursion railroad. But the conference center would do a couple of things. It would provide that place for people to come and spend the night, as they do all some of the other things that occur in Mason County. And it could also be used to help finance the rehabilitation and the exhibits in the roundhouse. An example I'll use of that is you go to a resort and you pay resort fees now, and it's anywhere from $5 to $25 or even more a day. Something like that could be repurposed and be put towards rehabilitation activities. That, we suggest, could also fall within that 2018 to 2024 timeline. The difference between that and the full-fledged museum is that you have to find a private developer operator to be able to do business with. And we estimate the cost on that, and these are total project costs of $8 to $30 million. Slide 4, please. This is the last slide, and we used it only basically to talk about the redevelopment potential that is there. And when we're talking about the potential for a conference center or hotel, we're looking primarily across Front Street, but it also might be possible in that what's called the triangle locally. The advantage of it being between Front and Railroad Avenue there is it really helps to knit the downtown back to the mill site and all of the things that are happening along the waterfront. So it could link up potentially with the trail that's coming from the marina, potentially to Eagle Point, and all of the remediation that's happening in Oakland Bay. Ideally, we would love to see Goldsboro Creek and that bridge incorporated in it into any kind of development, because waterfront is obviously of great appeal to people. The main thing, though, that I think needs to happen here in Shelton next is to create the vision and to get some acceptance and some consensus around what could happen here. We see and hear great enthusiasm about repurposing this. This is a significant property, not only nationally, but it's especially significant locally. And it is the Shelton, the Simpson legacy here. But I think that it's very important that the community galvanize around it, because it will take the entire community and it will take the long haul to make something here happen that will make a significant difference in downtown and for Shelton. And that is the end of my presentation. I'd be happy to take any questions that you might have. Tracy.
I have a question. When we're talking about expanding the grounds for the museum and having space to have more more buildings that could contain the whole project. We have a number of vacant properties across the street from there along Front Street that are probably some pollution is there. There's an old oil tank and everything. Mm-hmm. Is this typically done, this new type of development? Can this be expedited by cleaning up that through EPA grants?
Yes, definitely. My experience with private developers is they are the most risk-adverse people in the world. So anything that you can do up front to remediate risk on their part is to your advantage. Okay. It helps to attract.
Okay, so I think one thing that I have always thought is that some of those properties would be an excellent location for a logging museum, because we don't have room in the roundhouse for all the logging equipment too, mm-hmm. but it seems that if people were really interested in the roundhouse and the trains, they would also be interested in that portion of the timber industry as well. And it seems like it would make sense to have it in close proximity.
I would agree. And as a historian, I would just also say that we are losing the remnants of our logging heritage very quickly in Western Washington. And there really isn't, various museums have a piece of that story. But not a full-blown exploration of that story and what that industry has meant to Washington. And as a historian, I would love to see that happen and not only be locally oriented, but more oriented toward that entire story and what happened at the beginning and what's happening as it winds down.
I can just see starting interest in other types of business, like maybe a railroad car store where people go buy their model railroad equipment and, you know, the railroad museum or the railroad hotel, or it just seems like it could easily take off to me. And is that something that would typically happen when an endeavor like this starts?
I would say yes, but my caveat would be it has to be very high quality museum, mm-hmm. And it has to be well run, well staffed, and with rotating exhibits. It has to be first mm-hmm. rate. So I've always said that it is much easier to get funding for capital improvements than it is to be able to figure out how you run an operation like this on a year-to-year basis. That's the trick. And most museums now have to operate with several forms of earned income. Mm-hmm. And whether that's gift shop, it's not just gift shop and tickets anymore. Every one of them is looking for ways to make money, ways to partner with different groups and entities in the community. And certainly, the experience has been with something, if what we have envisioned, and I think you've envisioned, would come to pass, it would certainly have spin-off effects, mm-hmm. most definitely, in terms of retail mm-hmm. and potentially other industries. So
if we were to decide to go ahead with this and we wanted to pursue this, of course I want to, what would be the following steps? I mean, what would be the most important things that we could do? I mean, obviously keep negotiating for the actual property transfer, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But...
Well, as I said at the end, I think the biggest thing here is to create that community vision. Okay. And so the first thing I would do is to look to see how do you do that. Is it through some sort of city-sponsored task force or that involves lots of members of the public and various organizations? I think you have to decide that. But I really think you need that grounding in order to proceed.
And I'm taking up all the questions. And do you consider that excursion rail an integral part of this?
Absolutely. I think excursion rail could be very much a significant earned income stream. It is certainly that in California, in Sacramento, and it is that at Mount Rainier Scenic Railroad. And they expect their excursion traffic to grow substantially over the course of the next 5 years. And so it could easily be half the annual operating costs of a museum.
Wonderful. Okay. Great.
Any other questions?
No, something to think about.
It's been my pleasure to work on this and my pleasure to be here with you this evening. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mary.
Yeah.
Well, next is the general public comment period. So if anybody wants to talk more about railroads and the roundhouse, this would be an opportunity to do that. You can just sign your name on the little paper right on the end of the thing. And we have a 3-minute time amount there. And so this would be an opportunity to speak. Okay.
Mayor, I've got a list of the people. The first one up is Daryl Barker.
Okay, Daryl.
Hi.
Just state your name for the record, please.
I'm Daryl Barker.
Okay.
You want my address?
Nope. I don't think so.
Okay. 3 minutes is not a lot of time, and I think, Tracy, did you give them my full sheet?
Yes.
Okay, so you'll have time to read all the paragraphs, but if I may summarize, and I'm a good writer, but I'm not a very good public speaker, so if you'll allow me to read it, thank you. Your city website indicates that you commissioners have dedicated yourselves to ensuring your citizens that you'll build a strong community together and encouraging and participation in all matters that affect your citizens. I respectfully ask, does that include all your citizens or just the religious minority of your citizens? I'm sorry, religious majority of your citizens. I needn't remind you that since the 1782 E Pluribus Urnum was a de facto motto on the Great Seal of the United States until the McCarthy era in 1956, where many in power were marinated in the hysteria about who was an atheist communist and who was a Christian patriot. That's when Congress adopted In God We Trust as our official motto. Congress was wrong then, and Congress is wrong now. If at all, it should read In God Some of Us Trust. You already know that our U.S. Constitution has no mention of a God whatsoever contained within it. And surely you are astutely aware of the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment, where it says our government should not establish an official religion and or prohibit the free exercise thereof. It's a win-win situation. You, as our government representatives, are obligated to stay neutral in religious matters. And of course, I hope you're aware of the Treaty of Tripoli. Was proposed by our first president, George Washington, and signed on November the 4th in 1796 by President John Adams, where it clearly states that the United States, and I quote, the United States government is not in any sense founded on the Christian religion. It is outright misleading for those who have approached you before who are contrarily proposing otherwise, telling you that this our founding fathers wanted a Christian nation when in fact they didn't. I'll wrap this up by saying I'm here today asking that you commissioners consider voting against this plaque out of the respect for the First Amendment and for all of your non-religious citizens and Christians also that are not comfortable with the plaque In God We Trust. Is Shelton going to be a secular government or a theocracy is my question. If you vote for its placement, I and many of your Shelton non-religious citizens will be back asking for equal time. We will be requesting your approval of a plaque that reads, In Reason We Trust. If not, then at least can you put on E Pluribus Unum? Can you put on We the People? Whichever, but it is definitely will be something that reflects what the Founding Fathers intended for our secular nation to be. And I'm Daryl Barker representing the Freedom From Religion Foundation. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. We have somebody else.
Next one up is Robert Ray to talk about the same thing.
I am Robert Ray. It has come to my attention that it is the intention of this government agency to prominently display the motto, In God We Trust. I would like to make my dissent known and offer an alternative. First, however, let me introduce myself. I am Robert Ray, Executive Director of the Original Motto Project, a nonprofit organization that advocates for the prominent display of the Latin motto, E Pluribus Unum, or From Many One, or We the People from the Constitution, as one that represents a truly inclusive nature of American society. This message is one of inclusiveness. It takes all points of view, and sometimes the quarrels between those competing viewpoints, to make America the richly pluralistic society it is. In God We Trust, though, it is currently enshrined by law as the official motto of the United States. It is inherently divisive. Not only does it exclude a significant minority, the non-religious, but it also excludes those religions that believe in multiple gods, as well as those that believe in none, like Buddhist. Furthermore, it is an unfortunate fact that many government agents and agencies who display the motto believe it to be an overt endorsement of the Christian belief, When used in such context, Ingalls Trust violates the most sacred of American principles, the separation of church and state. E Pluribus Unum, we believe, is a motto that encapsulates the variety of experience and belief in this great country. It first appeared on the proposal for the serial of the United States in 1776, where it represented the union of colonies who, despite deeply rooted differences amongst themselves, united to throw off the shackles of oppressive and arbitrary governance. The seal prominently displaying E Pluribus Unum was approved by Congress in 1782. We the people are the first words written on the document that officially formed the United States of America. Those words, like E Pluribus Unum, became the glue that has held this nation together through war and peace. They are the epitome of what our founders wanted for this nation. While you may still choose, of course, to display the motto "In God We Trust," the original motto project humbly asks you consider a compromise that can satisfy both viewpoints on this issue. Mount E Pluribus Unum, or We the People, in an equally prominent and honorable place along "In God We Trust." As a side note, the original motto project would be willing to finance any such plaque or sign. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next person, Lisa Renfro.
Yes, I wanted to speak on the same subject matter, but a different opinion. I wrote a letter, I sent it, but it's sort of long. I'm not a great writer or a great speaker, but I'm simply, to be simple, to summarize what I was trying to say, is would you put a Ford emblem on a Mercedes? Would you change the word to appease all the people when the word doesn't really represent everyone's opinion? I understand that fact, but listening to everyone else, maybe it is a good idea to change the word, but maybe to to the word unity, or in unity we trust, or in peace, because if God is for peace and unity, and you have integrity and holistic virtue, we are all one, and we're for all one for keeping peace, and I think that's what God stands for.
Thank you.
Josh Kylo.
Good evening. My name is Josh Kavo. I was the last railroad mechanic for the Simpson Lumber Company. I'd like to discuss the roundhouse tonight. First of all, I'd like to thank Mary Thompson for her proposal ideas. I'd just like to make a comment that I think her cost numbers are a little exorbitant. I've personally been involved with railroads, railroad construction, locomotive maintenance and repair, professionally and as a volunteer for the past 6 years. I am currently the chief mechanical officer for the Lake Watcom Railway up out of Cedro Woolley. And I'd just like to say that the cost numbers that she threw out, I could tell that there was a big gasp across the room as soon as those came out. And I think they're a little high. In my personal opinion, a museum, yes, it'd be nice to shoot for the $28 million museum, but I could see that coming along in stages. Look at Snoqualmie. We've got several multi-million-dollar buildings there. They did not all happen at once. That museum, it started back in the 1950s as a little more than a scrapyard, and it's becoming world class. It's taken a long time to get there, but it does draw the people out. It does do the job of interpreting the railroad story. I believe we could do something like that here. Start small, start with the roundhouse, turn it into a living, working museum. We can maintain the locomotives and rolling stock in there. Another source of course, the excursion trains. That is a very vital source of revenue for the museum project. Mary did mention a destination, and yes, most sustainable railroads, they have some type of major destination. Mount Rainier, they've come up with they've run from LV to their museum at Mineral. But also look at Sacramento State Railroad Museum, which she mentioned numerous times. They have an excursion train, and it does not have a destination. It is actually, somewhat separate from the museum proper. It's, a couple, three blocks away to get to the train station, and it runs about 3 miles just down the levee and kind of the the backsides of Sacramento. I've ridden that train several times. Strasburg Railroad, one of the premier tourist railroads in the nation, operates in Pennsylvania. They do a lot of contract work for other railroads. That is one of their biggest sources of revenue stream. I believe we get the right team involved here, we could do something like that. Again, that's something that I would be willing to help the city get something like that going. I'd like to go on record as saying that. I've talked to Tracy numerous times about this. That's a very good way to go look at it. The roundhouse, I think we can develop that space to perform that type of work. And it's a very, very doable situation for very, very little capital, from what I understand, in my personal and professional experience. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your comments.
Thank you.
It's all on the list. Anyone else want to talk? This is the opportunity. We have another one later in the meeting, but seeing nobody stepping forward, I think we'll move forward into the area of the consent agenda. Are we ready for a reading of the consent agenda?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Could we please have a reading of the consent agenda?
Consent agenda number one, vouchers numbered 11504 through 11548 in the amount of $447,820.96. Handwritten warrant number 11503 in the amount of $849.86 to the Department of Licensing. Handwritten warrant number 11550 in the amount of $25 to the Washington Association of Code Enforcement. Commission meeting minutes from the business meeting of April 18th, 2016. 2016 Stripe Right contract authorized the mayor to sign when returned from the contractor and the city administrator to make any necessary budget adjustments.
Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda as read?
I move that we approve the consent agenda as read.
I second that.
There's a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? The consent agenda passes. There is no old business this evening, but we have several items under new business. And the first is Mr. Steve Goins, again, is going to talk to us about our comprehensive plan capital facility.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. Let me begin by passing out a updated draft of the capital facilities element.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, they got a study like if you read too much TV, it's not good for you. Steve helps us so we don't have time for TV. I guess I'll live long and happy.
I haven't watched TV in years.
There you go. Yeah, if you have to write this stuff, I'm sure you don't.
As I've stated previously, we're in the throes of a comprehensive plan update here. What we're considering is the initial draft comments of our capital facilities element. This element describes an array of capital facilities in town that we want to look at, and as we contemplate growth in the community, how that growth may impact our ability to provide services and what we would need to do to address levels of services to maintain those or enhance those in some cases. Some of the things that describes that are not under the city umbrella, as it were, would be, for instance, the facilities at Mason General Hospital. The plan does describe some of the enhancements that they completed here in recently. And they've done a great deal of work to maintain and improve their level of service. We described the Shelton School District and the needs at the various schools, and looking forward what those population increases and student increases would mean in terms of their facilities, as well as our own facilities. There is an overview of our different utilities in town, stormwater, water, sewer, our solid waste utilities, and describing how those facility needs can be met over time. This does contemplate a different population projection than I described in our land use element. We're still working with Mason County to land on a agreed projection. We're very close, but this is really just intended to get you to have a chance to look over the document, provide some input. Like the other versions I provided, this has the stricken and underscored language, so you can see what the document said previously, what changes are being made. Another feature with this is there's some highlighted pieces. The pieces are highlighted in yellow. Those are the original language that's in the comp plan currently, but I thought you might want to look at those closely, and you might want to consider making changes to those. I did not propose changes in the draft you have, but I thought you might want to consider that. So I wanted to make sure that those were highlighted for you, so as you looked at it, you'd
pick that up. Yeah, we just cut those, so this talks about increasing them, so that probably wouldn't quite work.
So I'll be back with this again in a few weeks. In the interim, if you have comments or questions, or obviously if you want to provide me input on this draft, this is that opportunity to have that back and forth. And over time, I'll be assembling all this, as I've stated before, to bring this back as one document later in the year. I'll be passing this version of the draft out to various entities like the hospital and the schools and others, and give them a chance also to provide comment and input before this comes back to you. Hopefully that'll be in the next few weeks.
All right, any questions or comments for Steve?
No.
We will study this.
Lots of reading.
All right, next is a number two. And number two is, I thought it was a misprint, historical research, but I was thinking, it must be historical, but no. So I didn't know there was a word, historical, but Dave, I guess you're going to talk to us about this. Is that correct?
These rascals made up their own word.
Historical.
Rascals.
I put it in out of my word processor and then read squiggly
lines. There you go.
Did you know a few years ago we learned that our landfill had not properly been closed, so we contacted ecology to do what should have been done properly 30 years ago, 40 years ago. More recently, what we've done since talking to ecology is hiring a consultant to help us put together a plan. Thankfully, it's mostly grant funded. On the other hand, the results of the study is going to tell us what we have to do, and it's going to be costly, and those costs are looming. And what I've recently learned is that we may be insured against that loss. Don't know for sure, but it's a possibility. So the way Steve actually identified these guys got me into a meeting with them, and with the representative. And essentially what they do is look at old insurance policies that were in force, 40 years ago, and then tell you whether or not that insurance company provided coverage. Based on what they're saying, there's a good chance that it does. Currently, insurance policies are many, many pages long, mainly to provide for exclusions against environmental losses. Largely, and the old timers didn't do that. They had more general language. These old insurance policies have been through the court system, and the courts have said that no, you got to pay. You don't have an exclusion, then you have to pay for the loss. So we don't know whether we had the right kind of policy or not. But in fact, we don't even have records that go back that far. But this company knows how to find them. They have ability to find the things that we can't find for ourselves. So we just have to turn them loose. They collect a fee. It's a contingency fee. So if we don't get any benefit, we don't pay. On the other hand, if we do get benefit, it's 15%. So that could be a lot of money, but if you recognize that they're covering 85% of the total cost, then actually, although it costs us a lot of money, it actually saves us a lot of money if it works out. The other thing is it may be able to recover costs that we've already experienced. I mean, for instance, when we did the Basin 2 sewer rehabilitation, no, actually, think it was Basin 2, we had to dig up a street down deep because there had been a gas station nearby, and we had to excavate all the contaminated soil, haul it away, and replace it with fresh soil, which is quite expensive, and that is potentially recoverable as well. So the first step is to determine whether or not we're insured, and once that's complete, then we'll know where to go after that, and we need to engage this company in that with this contract in order to be able to do that first step. There are some other responsibilities that are ours, such as doing the kind of work that we're doing right now with the grant to do the investigation to see, basically, to determine what responsibilities we have there. So, but at any rate, there's basically. I've processed this as though there was very little to lose and everything to gain. So that's, I'll answer your questions if you have any.
I know of one other person that's going through this process, and they did find in their old claim money, and it is being taken care of. So if you ever want me to approve something, you bring, just always add that the city has very little to lose at this time. And I'll always approve that. So I read through it. I think it's the right step for us to do. So I would support this.
Just the staff then recommends that we place it on next week's consent agenda.
Okay, do we concur with that?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. And Mr. O'Leary, I believe you're next on this Ford Escape purchase. I can turn
I think
over
that's that's Mr. Clark.
I think, oh, I see. Oh, that's interesting. They put your name there. But actually, it's presented by Greg Clark. It just said it's presented to you. I don't know why you get the car. I'm just reading my fine print, that's all. All right, Mr. Clark, were you going to talk to us about this car?
I need a new car, too.
Yeah,
I do, too. Can you find all of us one?
Mayor, commissioners, good evening. We have an opportunity. We were approached by PUD3. They're surplusing some of their vehicles, and this Ford Escape was attractive. It's a good car, I think, to function as an engineering car around town. It's had a little wear and tear, but it's actually in not too bad a shape, and we are entertaining purchasing it. When I drafted this up, I was under the impression that Kathy Byerly and I would be able to arrive at a funding strategy for this out of some savings I thought I had from last year. I'm not sure if I do or not, so actually, maybe we can put this on old business next week, but I need to meet with Dave now that he's back and discuss this matter with Kathy regarding the actual funding for it. But it is a good value. It's in good shape and would serve us very well as an engineering kind of all-around vehicle to do field trips and review different things in the field. So if that's possible, we'll put it on old business next week and do that.
I think that would be the logical move. So if we concur to do that, then I think we can bring this back. And you're going to bring us back the financial piece to the puzzle.
Yes.
So do we concur to put this under old business?
Yes.
Okay. Done deal. We did it. All right. Now administration reports. We have one presented to us, I guess, by you, Mr. Clark, again.
Yes, Mike, Michael, and I will be doing this. I think we need to go up there so we can see the slides as they are displayed on the screen behind us. Either that or I need to get some rear view mirrors or something.
There we go.
It's
motorcycle mirrors. There we go.
And not to belabor the point that I do have a practice session coming up real soon. So
practice?
Yeah. I got practice with the hog barbecue. And so they're setting up the instruments. They've got a room all. And so just be short in your presentation.
We're going to try and be as short but as thorough as possible.
Got to be thorough.
We have to be thorough. We have to bring you all the data that we can so you have everything to make a good decision. So
some more TV avoidance documentation.
Boy, it's tough to read.
As long as it doesn't take away from The Walking Dead.
Okay. All right, so Mike and I are going to kind of tag team this particular presentation. In 2014, the commission made a decision regarding whether or not to engage in capital funding for an Upper Mountain View pressure zone related project. That involved a significant amount of study and back and forth with regard to whether or not to accept or not a loan grant opportunity. We can go ahead and go to the next slide. This particular map I've presented here, Dave and I met earlier today. This is kind of in pretty simplistic form, but it shows the pieces of the puzzle. The pink on the outer northerly part of our city is the Upper Mountain View pressure zone. The blue in the center is the Mountain View pressure zone. And then as you see the yellow there, that's our Capitol Hill pressure zone area. The green is the downtown, and then the orange down below is Angleside. And those are all served by different pressure zones within our water system.
And that's just because there are different elevations. And if you try to do it all at once, somebody with low or no pressure and somebody with enough pressure is more often
high. Very sure.
Exactly. And so some of the pieces of the puzzle we'll be talking about today are shown on here. Specifically, well 3 was updated and along with parts of well 4 with the first phase of this capital effort we did, which is what we're calling phase 1. It brought us a new tank up. And that's shown there, a phase 1 new tank, which is located up by the Mason County Public Works area. You can see it as you drive up 101, and it's in the final finishing phases of getting painted. And we're hoping maybe in about 6 to 8 weeks we will have that tank up and operational, which will allow us to pressurize the water line that goes out to Washington State Patrol and serves that whole northerly part of the Upper Mountain View zone. What we're really here today to give you is a little bit of an update on the status of those, along with some choices you would have in moving forward into phase 2. So next slide. Oh boy, I told you I couldn't read this. And this happened to me last night, believe this or not. I took my contact out and I'm thinking, I better remember to put that in because I'll probably be reading something false.
Mike Michaels is right there. He can read it.
Fortunately, I can read that one even without my glasses.
Okay. So we also, the commission authorized us to, because we have both Simpson Mill was going out of a business down there. We had Sierra Pacific moving into town. They had certain needs for water. We also have a new development, Shelton Hills, that is a need for water for a future development up there. And we want to make sure that our system can provide for those and what is needed in order to provide for that. So that was done in part of a water modeling effort that we had done here, and we just got the results in March of this year. And I'm going to let you read the finer print, Mike.
Yeah, so as Greg said, you know, SPI coming in and their request for fire flow in particular at the existing mill site downtown, as well as some more updated information both on the water system layout as well as timing of development of Shelton Hills. All of that in conjunction with a failure of our well 1 last summer. As you may recall, we came to you last summer and let you know that we were having some issues with the well. And those issues have continued. Essentially, at this point, well 1 is, we can still get water out of it, but it's really considered unusable. We have a significant drawdown of the water level during full production of that well, which runs a risk of the well failing completely, or I guess the worst case, bad case, we burn up a pump because we don't have enough water on top of it. So those three things combined, we really felt it was an opportune time to go back in and look at the model, adjust some things for changes that have occurred in the last couple of years. And so Carollo, who did the last major update as part of the comp plan, took on that task for us. And really, that's the report that I gave you. There's a lot of technical information there, a somewhat technical summary, and a really high-level summary here. So basically, three things are coming out of this report. One, with well one being relegated to unreliable, we're down to two wells. We have well three and well four left. And with those two wells online, we're in a point where we really can't reliably provide service to our existing customers, let alone new customers. Well three and four combined produce 2,200 gallons a minute, one at 12, one at 1,000. Our standard for reliable service is that our average day demand, the average day and how much water our citizens use on that average day, needs to be covered by our sources, our wells, with the biggest one offline. So if we take the 1,200 off, we'll have 1,000 gallons a minute available. Our current average day demand is 1,098 gallons a minute. So it's not by much, but we cannot provide that average day need of our current citizens. If we go to the next level, which is that maximum day demand, which is our summer peak day, we're really in the hole. Right now, the maximum day demand for our system is about 2,800 gallons a minute. So even with both wells up and running, we're using our storage in a way we probably shouldn't be. So well one, as you may or not recall from past discussions, is our largest producer right now. That's 1,500 gallons a minute. That's a big piece of our source supply right now. So basically, the model says we need to replace well one. Redevelopment is what it says, but essentially we need to drill a brand new well. We also really need to do the ground level tank and the booster station that were contemplated as part of the phase two Upper Mountain View implementation. And we need those two components to correct the remaining storage deficiencies that exist in the what's left of the Mountain View pressure zone, and that was identified in the original comp plan. We also need that storage there to provide the remaining necessary storage for the new pressure zone, and also to provide a source redundancy. Right now, with the work we're finishing up, we have a single source to the new tank. Well, three will be the only source, and without the work at well one, though we have a couple pieces built into the system that would allow us to get water there, they're not very reliable, and that's not their general intent. So the other thing that comes out of here, the third point there, is really if we fix these storage issues, and it's predominantly the storage issues, then we know we can provide reliable service to our current customers. We can provide the service to SPI that they're asking for, additional fire flow. And we know that from the way the model's working right now, that at least the first initial phases of Shelton Hills, we can serve off of the existing Mountain View pressure zone, you know, the pressures that are existing at the Walmart area, for example. So,
I was just going to say, in short, the needs for phase two are defined right here. We have the need for well one because the first well one has failed. We need to redrill that to have redundancy and the ability to provide customers our water. We need the storage in order to provide for that fire storage and to provide a backup for well three, which is the only well that can provide for Upper Mountain View unless, you know, we do something here. And then certainly the storage to allow for the development of our new customers. So with that, let's go to the next slide.
This is our commission options. So basically, given where we're at with our design, with the current status of our system, really the commission's got three choices now instead of two like we had talked about previously. We've got to stop and do no more of the phase two work, which basically leaves us finishing up the contracts that we put out about a year ago. Option two really would be to go ahead and replace well one and get that back as an active source. And just a side note, if we do that, it will no longer be well one, it will be well five. And then the third option really is to continue on with the capital improvements that the commission approved about a little over a year ago, and that's finishing up essentially the phase two work. As part of that, you probably remember that there were some necessary long-term components in there, but not necessarily needed in the short term. And part of the recommendation we're going to give you today is to pull back some of those longer-term needed components and save that work for later. Just do what we need of phase two to really fully implement the new pressure zone. The outcomes from the various options, if we do nothing, we leave our customers at a pretty high elevated level of risk. The deficiencies that exist in the water system will probably make it difficult for us to provide good service to our customers. Replacing well one will definitely improve that situation, but it's likely not going to provide the sufficient system capacities we need for some of the development that's right on the edge right now. And by doing the work that's already anticipated, that's nearly complete with design, we're going to have a very long-term stability and reliability for our current customers, as well as some reasonable amount of capacity for growth and expansion. So,
Questions, comments? We have the study here. We can read this, and are you going to bring this back next week?
We have more to go.
We have more to go.
Oh, gee, I'm sorry. I was already out the door. Go ahead.
So here's a quick synopsis of where we are. The upper cloud there is what we're calling the phase one construction. That's the contracts we let out already. As Greg discussed, that's the new tank out of Mason County Public Works, the upgrades to well three to get that online, a little bit of water main work, and a pressure reducing valve station. Phase two, which is what we're finishing the design on right now, is the replacement of well one now. A ground level storage tank, about 1 million gallons at that location, as well as a booster pump station to get the water into the system, and associated water main improvements to make all that happen. There's some additional remaining work, particularly some improvements to connect the Johns Prairie area, the northeast portion of the Upper Mountain View zone, into that zone and raise the pressures there. As well as a second tank that was originally planned out at Mason County Public Works. And those are the pieces that right now we're recommending that the commission delay on. Our recommendation is going to be that we continue with the phase two construction and complete implementation of the Upper Mountain View pressure zone. Next
slide.
So a little quick financial update on where we're at. You see the top chart up here. The first section there is the contracts that we currently have out. The Upper Mountain View elevated tank, that's all of the work associated there. You can see currently we're at about $2.7 million of expense, including our administrative costs. We're projecting the contract to be done at just under $3.4 million. Side note there, we actually awarded a contract for $3.4 million, so our team is doing really good out there. And the well three upgrades, you'll see that we're projecting that contract to come in at about $990,000. And again, we actually awarded a contract for slightly more than what our total cost is going to be. We just last week received the most recent update on our engineer's estimates. And we've adjusted some of the contingencies that had some very conservative contingencies in there. I've left some in, taken some out that seem too conservative, and the components that really are left to do are the well one replacement and the booster tank or booster pump station in the tank. You'll see that from the chart up here, well one is about $1.3 million for the work that needs to be done there to get the well back online. And then if we were to go to the second step, which would be fully implementing it into the Upper Mountain View, the tank and the booster station to do that's about another 3.7. We're about $9.4 million total in all of the project, including a contribution from Mason County for some work that was completed under the tank project. Our total available funding right now, minus any reserve funds in the utility that have been coming in, is just shy of $9.1 million. As we mentioned, we're recommended to lay in two pieces of project. That's the John's Prairie area and the second tank. And those together are about $3.2 million that we're recommending setting aside right now. I think that's all we have on this one. So next slide. So as part of the previous approvals, the commission adopted some new rate structure. 2-3% raises and then 4-4% increases that are currently slated in the water codes, Title 15. That related to three pots of money, essentially. A pot of money to deal with inflationary increase, predominantly in our operation costs. And then we structured it in previous presentations to show the debt service necessary to cover the work that's currently under contract, plus debt service for the work that's yet to be done. And you'll see that noted in the red and green. The work that we're currently completing, that's about 8 cents. And this was based on a then $25 average water bill based on 184 gallons a minute and the 2013 water rates. The work that we're looking at now is gonna add about a nickel to that, the work that's actually done. And then if we were to go on finish completing the Upper Mountain View implementation using the remaining Department of Health funds, it's gonna add about another 17 cents. So it's gonna be about a dollar total onto that $25 bill.
So I might just mention, the rates you approved in 2014, that's what these reflect the numbers on. And those rates that you passed, we had 2 years of a 3%, and then all the other following years were at a 4% rate increase. And we're not suggesting we change those at all. That those are adequate funding to provide the adequate money to do both phase one and phase two work. But as we suggested, we suggest anyway that we delay the Johns Prairie piece and that we delay building that second tank out of Mason County. So go to the last slide here.
Greg, what are the costs of leaving Johns Prairie off and building the and not building that tank?
About $3.2 million.
Okay. And how far out can we see that? How far out in the future would we have to? That could go way out.
That could go quite a ways out.
We wouldn't have to worry about that for a long time.
Yeah. Our system will be sitting, based on this modeling effort, mm-hmm. the system will be sitting in pretty good shape for quite a while. Some of it depends on how fast Mark Hall, the Shelton Hills project, develops, but based on the schedule they just recently gave us a couple months ago, we're good to go there. We won't need that second tank volume until about year 10 or so in their plan.
And then we talked about when we start getting some building and some businesses and new houses and whatever comes into Shelton,
mm-hmm.
we start building up that cushion. We can pay off this a lot quicker.
We can. There's okay. no prepayment penalties in these okay. funding packages.
All right, I just
so.
Wanted to make sure.
Just for your knowledge, too, also, again, we have been talking quite a bit about that. I personally will not support the rate increases next year. So just to let you know, if both of these other commissioners do, then they can do that. But that will affect my – I'm not going to do it next year. So just in the back of your minds, just remember, you got one vote and no rate increases on this next year, just for informational purposes.
At this point, we're not talking about additional rate increases. We're talking about the rates that are already in our code.
So just to let you know, I will vote not to do that also.
So the last piece we have here is, it was brought up a couple times that, you know, should we save the money and build this with cash somewhere down the road? So previously, we tried to figure out how to present that answer to that question and really didn't come up with it until just earlier this week. So we basically got two scenarios, the continue now or wait until later and save the money. If we finish now, the remaining Department of Health funds are roughly $4.7 million. That's a 20-year 1% loan, currently approved as part of the funding package and available to us. The life of that loan, we would pay about just slightly over $5.2 million or about $260,000 a year. Looking at, if we save the money for it, and assuming our plan was to be done at the end of 20 years, and no inflation on construction cost, and remember, our average construction inflation on a data set from about 96 to current is 3 to 4%. But assuming no inflation, we would still need to save $225,000 a year to be able to build this project in years 18 and 19 and 20. If inflation does stay where it's historically been, then we're looking at about $420,000 a year of savings to build this at the end of 20 years, and a total project cost at that time of about $9.3 million. So,
I have a question. What would happen if we froze the rates for next year, just kept them up where they are this year? What could you come up with some numbers that you could give me what that would look like?
Off the top of my head, no, but we can go back and look at it. I think generally there's a possibility there.
Okay.
For two reasons. Some of the assumptions in the financial model, and Vicki, in talking with her last week, reminded us of one. There's a 6% increase in benefits for our employees that's factored into that. That was historical until a couple of years ago when the benefits were restructured and got capped. So that will save us on some operational increases moving forward. The other thing that we've got going for us is the last time we looked at the model, we assumed that the debt service was going to start in late this year or next year. Right now, with the conditions of the funding package, primarily that our first payment isn't due until after completion, we're looking at not needing to make a payment on the debt portion of it until at least 2018, based on where we're at with the current design. So
that's a feasible thought.
It's a feasible thought. I'd have to go back and look at
the rates could be frozen next year.
I'd have to go back and look at the financial model.
Give the customers a breath of fresh air.
Yeah, possibly.
Okay. If you could do that, I'd appreciate that.
I just want to say, I think without question, we can certainly delay next year's rate increase in order to proceed this necessary work. And I think the way the model works is that that rate increase, the money that come in next year that would be a little bit less, is cumulatively gaining interest as you move out through future years. But to get us through the war here, to get these elements of the capital improvements done so that we can allow growth to happen, we can provide for the redundancy and safety of our customers, to have that second well and that for serving Upper Mountain View pressure zone, to fix well one that needs to get fixed, it just makes screaming sense to me that we would do what you suggest, and that is delay next year's rate increase, look at the cash flow, the debt service payments, and that as we get into future years, and if we need to make a slight rate adjustment in future years, then you know, maybe the economy will be a lot better to support that.
Yeah, I'm looking at, you know, hoping that with all the economy that's going to be coming into our city, building new businesses and whatever, that there'll be more money coming into our water and sewer. Mm-hmm.
And like Mike said, too, we've gained some time here because of delay that we won't have to make those first debt service payments until this work is completed, which then pushes us a year in the future to 18 instead of starting in 17.
Yeah.
So,
okay. I'd appreciate if I could have some numbers. That'd be great.
Yeah, we'll see what we can come
back
with.
Okay. Thank you.
Just another kind of just 2 cents on this is this city has used this strategy of we've got to do this now and borrow the money to do it because we just have to do it. It did it to the point where it was $60 million. And it's the same, we got to do it. And then there'll be something else. We got to do this now because if we don't, my goodness, something's going to happen. And at some point, we got to take a pause on this because we owe so much money. And in 10 years, nothing's come back to significantly help. When the rate payers got hit by a 36 or 38% rate increase a couple years ago, I mean, I screamed at any other way I could possibly not do that. And we had to do that at that point, okay? We have to slow the boat up. And I To be honest with you, I really would love another opinion on this whole subject. I'm just telling you, I would like to have another opinion on, you know, borrowing another, whatever we're going to borrow. We have borrowed ourselves into a hole that we are having a hard time digging out. And my personal feeling is taking a break from a lot of this stuff. I think we really need to take a look at this. And I'm just telling you, I think that you can take statistics and you can take things and you can make them say whatever you want. And I am very, very cautious on wanting to borrow another penny. I'm just very, very adamant that we have borrowed ourselves into a $60 million hole, and we're crawling out, and we will crawl out. But before we borrow any more money, I don't know. I just don't get all caught up in that if something major happens, all the water pressure stops. I think we've done this so much that we just got a habit of borrowing money and putting in and then something else. We got to do this or something. We just ran ourselves into a hole, and I am one that wants to crawl myself out. And it's hard to crawl out when you dig another hole and jump farther down. So I am real concerned about borrowing any money at this time.
I have some questions about Kathy's idea here. So if we were to... And I'm a little bit unclear. Are you talking about freezing the rates as they are now and not going ahead with it? Is it 4%? So if we do that, and did you have a specific time for a year or?
Well, for 2017, for this coming upcoming year.
So at the end of that time, what would the increase need to be to meet our debt service?
I think that's the point Mike's saying. We would need some time to go back and, you know, put that into the rate model and identify what those would be. But my gut tells me that we would be fine.
And on a regular city residential bill, I know they vary, but that would be about a $4 increase a month or decrease?
No, 4% is about $1 on the average water bill. Now, using the 184 gallons per day number that is kind of the overall average for our residential customers, that's about, it gets closer to 27 with a couple years of rate increase that's in, but it's in that $25 to $27 range right now.
But I guess what, I like Kathy's idea. What I would like to avoid is having another big jump increase at the time of you know, when we bring the rates up to where they should be.
Well, I think that's where we're looking. If we just do it 1 year and see what the economy looks like at the end of that 1 year, you know, I like the 1 year length. See what the economy is doing and what it looks like for our water, for future water bills. That's
what we got to get into a pay-as-we-go kind of a situation, because, you know, we've just responded to every emergency there is, and we're having a hard time right now. Let me, so I can come back from my little anger mode, let me just ask this, okay? We started out wanting to borrow $9 million, and we approved the first phase, the 4.5, okay? We've almost completed that. We're moving forward. The tank's getting painted. Now, what you're proposing is dropping the Johns Prairie line, and you said something to save like $3 million if we don't do that. So,
well, that's, remember, there's also a second tank at the Mason County shop that's planned in this, a duplicate to the one that's there.
So if we did what you wanted to do, how much money would you like the city to borrow?
We would, under the current recommendation, we would use the entire funding package that was approved by DOH. That includes...
Back to the $4.5 million.
This is the total $9 million, of which approximately $2.1 is essentially grant. They call it principal forgiveness, but yeah, it's essentially grant. Brings our loan amount down to just shy of $7 million.
Okay, so loan $7 million. We've already committed to $4.whatever.
We've actually committed to just over $2.3 million.
$2.3 million.
Yes, because we've spent enough to get all of the principal forgiveness.
Okay, so we are still looking for another $4 million.
About $4.7 million.
And so if we did that, if we borrowed that, then we would owe, who knows, $64 million to the city. Total. I'm talking total debt. I'm talking about past debt, all debt, because you're adding another $4 million on. That's the concern I have, is continuing. I mean, at some point, you got to say, wait a second, we need growth to catch up to us, because we've done everything for growth and we didn't see it. We're starting to see a little bit of it now, and I hope we see a lot more of it, but that's where the money kind of comes back in. So, I mean, I can see it holding at 60 million, that total for the city, or 58.3, but putting another 4 million right now into the city, I'm just having a real problem with that.
I don't think we're asking for that. I think that 4 million is included in the 9 million that we approved last year.
But we did not approve. Now we approved the first phase. We were going to, then we're coming back to look at the second phase.
We approved the first phase.
I can clarify that for you.
Could you please?
Yeah, the whole package was approved. Now, technically speaking,
and as a practical matter, you still have to award the bid on the second phase of the project.
So as a practical matter, we've got another step to do, another policy choice, another policy option
policy
at that
choice.
Point. But at this time, what's in play is a commission decision to proceed on the whole thing, subject to letting the bids. So,
yeah, we were told we can come back and take a look at that additional $4 million.
This is the process. This is the process. Yeah.
So we have the right to not approve that.
You do. Okay. You do. I'm just making sure everybody's got all the right.
Okay. Yeah, absolutely.
The history of this.
Yeah.
Okay.
The question is not an additional $4 million. It's using whether we're going to use the $4 million that we already have, the guaranteed 1% loan.
Sure. Low interest loans are great, but they still require a payment. And so all I can do is be honest and just say I'm concerned about these things. I'm concerned about the financial stability of the city of Shelton. And at what point do you start pulling things back and trying to let the economy pick up and catch up with where your debt has. That's just the way my mind works.
Well, I wasn't too concerned, Gary, until I found out that Well One was passed.
Sure.
That got me thinking, that's kind of scary.
I don't know why a private person can drill a well for $20,000 and it costs us $1 million. Can you explain that?
Well, our current Well 1 is approximately 750 feet deep, and the new well is projected to be approximately that deep. And it's a big one,
sure.
That's right.
It's not a 6-inch casing.
It's not a 6-inch. It's actually a triple casing in this case, a 12, an 18, and a 24 stacked on top of each other. So.
And none of my outrage is personal. My total, all I'm doing, I'm endeavoring to do what the people that voted me into this office to do, and that's put a hold on borrowing more money. And I'm going to do it any and every way I can. So if you got any creative ideas, we can do this without taking that other $4 million and adding it onto our debt. That's, if there's any other miracle wells or anything like that, or rainwater systems, I'm very much open for saving this city, borrowing another $4 million on top of already the 10 times more than the average. I don't know how much Chehalis owes. What's your total debt? Do you guys owe a million? 10, 5, 400 million?
We spent $40 million a few years ago on a sewer plant. So.
Four?
40.
40, right.
So
you do owe 40, right?
We have more than 40. We owe more than 40.
Well, then you're in the same boat we are, aren't you? You didn't vote that in, did you? Oh my goodness. Okay. All right.
And
just add a little humor into the. We want people to have water. There's no doubt about that. I got to be convinced beyond a shadow of doubt when I borrow more debt on top of debt. So we've gone a long time. And now, is there any other questions or comments concerning the Well One issue?
I want another comment.
Okay.
When we talked about this last year, the Well One wasn't in danger of going, was it, or was it? Right.
No. Based on the information, it's old. Well, one is about 75 years old.
Yeah.
But it was working fine. We had an ongoing issue with some sand production and some hydrogen sulfide, some rotten egg smelling out of the water. But other than that, it was fine. We did some testing over the summer, as well as put Well One back online to facilitate the demand we were seeing. and then that's when the problem happened. It worked fine for about 6 weeks.
Yeah. Well, once we got to using it for, you know, the summertime flows that we needed, it drew the curves right down. The water was sitting only about 5 feet above the wellhead. And it was at a point where we were almost mandated to turn it off. And we were able to keep up with well 3 and 4, but it's not a good situation. We need to fix well 1.
So what was, I can't remember, what was the cost of that well 1 to build?
I don't know. We should have printed that.
Yeah, we should have printed the slides out for us. If you can go back to that.
You said 1.3 million.
Yeah, I heard $1 million or something, $1 million for a well.
Yeah, okay. It's in the table in the presentation. 1.3 sounds about right. So
in my opinion, that's a necessity. We have to do that.
And that really, that's about $350,000 in construction costs that when we started this 2.5 years ago, we didn't anticipate.
Okay.
Even when we started this about 6 years ago and got the $9 million DOH package, we definitely didn't anticipate it then. So. Drilling the well itself is about a $350,000 endeavor.
Any more questions or comments concerning water?
I would just like to say again that I think Kathy might be on a really good track here. And I would just like to have those numbers as far as if we do put these rate increases on hold for a year, then how is that going to affect the next scheduled rate increases? And it won't be.
It might not affect it at all if we see some income mm-hmm. coming into our city.
And it might not be a huge amount for the average ratepayer, but it might be at least something that we can do to make it a little easier. So I would be interested in seeing more more figures about that too.
We'll do that.
We'll make that adjustment.
All right. Any other questions or comments concerning this issue? And at this time, turn it over to the city administrator for more future administration reports.
Isn't there another general public comment time?
It's coming
are
up.
You're gonna
I see.
Never mind.
Well, I just wanted to announce that I have submitted my resignation to the city, and they know that. And my last day here will be May 16th. So I move on.
How many years?
I move on to taking a job in Florence, Oregon. So
how many years?
How many years? Let's see, 16 years this year. Yep.
We're going to miss you.
We're going to miss her.
Thank you very much.
We are. I emailed her today. We're going to miss you, you know. Yeah. And the thing is, Vicki hasn't just worked here for 16 years. She grew up in this town.
It's true.
I mean, she was born like in this town.
But she's not selling her house, so she'll be back.
Oh, no, she'll be back.
Yeah, I will be back.
6 months or so, you know. So.
This is an adventure.
All right. Thank you for sharing that with us.
Nothing further, Your Honor.
Nothing further. Okay, there is another general public comment, 3 minute. If anybody would like to speak, they can. Seeing as how I missed my band practice, now the meeting can go on for 4 hours.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
I have some touches I'd like to touch on that aren't on.
Okay,
the...
let's do that. Okay, no more general public comment, right? Everybody's satisfied with that. Okay.
Oh. Lisa.
Good.
Okay, touch.
Okay, now,
Greg.
Okay, Greg.
Next week you're going to see, we've looked at and have now a recommendation on an automated fuel distribution system, which is budgeted and we'd like to move forward on. You'll see that. Also, I want to discuss, we last year, in conjunction with talking with the commission, built 2 MTA crossings, one on Railroad Avenue and one on Franklin Street, and that was a partnership. MTA contributed money in the actual delivery of the signals, and the dollars the crew spent on that particular project to do the sidewalk amenities on both sides, and that is being capitalized right now. So I just wanted to make sure the commission was aware that that was being done, because we're taking that out of some of the operations money. And then there's also some budget modifications we're going to bring next week for utilities that are small pieces of work that are capitalized. So, and that's it.
Any other administration final touches?
Vicki.
I also have a couple of budget modifications that we're going to be bringing forward. I should say, I think Tim is going to be bringing these forward. And it's for a website and record software, which we are putting into place this year.
Something I was expecting to see, and maybe I've spaced it, but there was a reduction in the amount of money that we should receive from Mason County into the Metropolitan Park District. And I'm going to want to process an amendment to that contract in the coming weeks before I go. So it's only about $6,000 or $8,000, but we actually got them to commit to pay it to us to compensate us for lost future taxing capability because of the levy shift and the levy shift that they're doing. Turns out that we would have lost that anyway, and so it really isn't fair to charge them. So
I think we already did that, didn't we?
Did we do that?
Yep.
Then I don't have any touches.
All right. Sounds good.
I'd hope that happened, but I didn't see it, and so I know, oh my gosh, we've forgotten about that. So.
All right.
Okay, so that's it, Your Honor.
And I want to thank this group for spirited debate. Okay, and our next meeting will be on Monday, May 9th at 2 p.m. in the afternoon. This meeting is adjourned.
Okay.